blessing today. We thank you for all you've been keeping us all this day. You took us out of the hostel and brought us out back safely. You not allow us to meet death on the road. You not allow us to meet any destruction there on our way out. You brought us back safely. Your grace has been keeping us.
Yes.
And it's just by your grace that we are here today, O Lord. We could have been doing other things. But you brought us here because of your grace, because of your mercy, because you yourself have chosen us. Oh Lord, I thank you so much for the gift of salvation that you've given all of us here. And Lord, we invite your presence here tonight as we gather in your name. Lord, we pray that you anoint this place and you fill this place with the Holy Spirit. And Lord, I pray every teaching that we get today will be under the ministration of the Holy Spirit.
Jesus,
teach us yourself, O Lord, these days. In the name of Jesus Christ, we've prayed. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Okay, we have a number of scriptures to read today, and the Lord will help us to really dig in and understand Genesis chapter 1. Yeah?
Genesis.
Do you have the Bible?
Yes, sir.
Ah, where's that? Where's your Bible?
This one.
Okay. I suggest we use this Bible, yes? Okay.
Is the Bible in this?
Which Bible?
Your Bible?
Which version is that?
Your Bible is here. Your one and only. This one.
Oh, you are saying we should use the Bible when you preach?
Yes.
Oh, I do.
But it's alright, you know. The prophet said it's always good to use it. All right, the word of God. In heaven, when the Lord showed his mighty prophet the new covenant, he said, in the new covenant of God, the ark of the new covenant, when the Lord showed it to him, there was the Bible, Holy Bible, inside the Ark of the New Covenant. And there, like this. Okay, I don't know how it was. So it's there. And then, lightning strikes the Bible 3 times in that vision. And then, the Lord told him what the lightning represents. The power, the authority, and the judgment of God against sin. And so, when someone stands up and preach at the pulpit, or in this place like this, someone is given the power, the authority to teach like this. The power, the judgment, and the authority of God against sin is present. Not lightning. To judge in the church. So if someone comes and do funny things here, the Lord himself will deal with them. So that's why pastors have such a huge responsibility. If they mess up, the Lord himself will hold them accountable and will even judge them on the pulpit. There have been pastors that died while preaching. And one of them, he died in church, but after just singing a secular song on the pulpit. He was preaching, and then somewhere, somehow, he decided to sing it. Whether he was using it as an example or what, to sing a secular song. And then, in the middle of preaching, immediately after he finished, and then, down. The power, judgment, and the authority of God against sin. Amen.
Amen.
Good. So today we are reading. We have 2 Corinthians 4:6 to read. We also have the book of Ephesians, chapter 4. Now, sure. Now, I want you to page to Ephesians chapter 4. Okay? Mm-hmm. Someone to page to Matthew chapter 5.
Matthew 5.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Alright?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, but in Genesis chapter 1. But yes, you read with me Genesis chapter 1. So you read Matthew.
Chapter 5.
And read what?
Ephesians.
Chapter 5 is?
Chapter 1,
skip there. 5. Okay, just verse chapter 1. Okay? Now, we said we want to look at the work of the Holy Spirit in transforming a person from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. So, what the Holy Spirit does in you when He transforms you, what kind of person that He does He make you to be? And so, when I read this scripture in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6, and today we'll read verse 6 and 7, I began to think, yeah, as what if, I said, what if I read Genesis chapter 1 in light of 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6? It was quite impressive because when I read 2 Corinthians 4, 6, as we read, I see Paul is drawing from Genesis. Now, he goes all the way back to Genesis to extrapolate, to extract this revelation that he revealed forth, that he tells us here in the book of chapter 4, verse 6 and verse 7. Are you sure? And I don't mind giving him that. All right. And I'm not sure if that is right. So, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6, it says, I'll read, yes? Mm-hmm. For God who said, let light shine out of darkness, has made His light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge, of God's glory, displayed in the face of Christ. Are you sure? In the days of technology, we can charge you. Okay. So it says, for God who said, let light shine out of darkness, has made His light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. Amen. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. Amen. So this is where it begins. Or should I say, this is where the inspiration came from. But what if we read Genesis chapter 1? But we can say together, we can turn together to Genesis chapter 1. So now when we look at Genesis chapter 1 here, we see a mighty work of the Holy Spirit in creation. Huh? Mm-hmm. And as I read this chapter, chapter 1 of creation, it's one of my very, very favorite chapters. I begin to see the gospel being preached in Genesis 1. So see, God has embedded the gospel in Genesis chapter 1. So as you go from one day to another, creating, as it were, creation maturing, yeah? Because as it, creation becoming perfect, you see, because on day one He said, let light shine out of darkness, yeah? But He was not done yet. And then you go to chapter the second day, and then He says what? Let the water separate. Yeah? So as He continues to create, maturing His creation, perfecting His creation, bringing His creation to to perfection, to completion, you begin to see the working of the Holy Spirit bringing the Christian to perfection. You see this trend, this powerful revelation of how the Holy Spirit works in the life of a Christian to make him that perfect image of Christ, to make him one that is a true image bearer of Christ. Image bearer, no? Mm-hmm. To make him the one? The image bearer of God's image. Amen? Mm-hmm. So, verse 1, we say, in the beginning, Okay, you read for us, yes.
Okay.
Verse 1 and 2.
In the beginning, God created heavens and earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters.
Amen. So God created the heavens and the earth, and then we see a problem. The earth was void, or formless, an empty waste. The Amplified say, and the earth was without form and an empty waste. Some translations say, and the earth was without form and void. Mm-hmm. Formless and empty. So you see a state of desolate state. You see a state of destruction. Empty. A state of emptiness. Like something is missing. There's this deep chasm. There's a problem here. Some observers, some scholars, they say, when you look at chapter 1, verse 1, it's as if everything was finished. Some people say. But then when you come to verse 2, verse 1 looks like everything was done. God created the heavens and the earth, finished. But now you see, in verse 2, it begins with a gloomy picture. It's like something happened between verse 1 and verse 2. God will tell us what happened. Yeah? But something happened, and we see that the earth was formless and empty. But now the Amplified says, an empty waste. And the next part now makes it even more interesting, because here you see that there was darkness upon the surface of the deep. So this was a real huge problem, that even darkness was there. Now, when we try to see the work of the Holy Spirit in this chapter, in the life of a person who's not born again, how the Holy Spirit transforms one from being the child of darkness to become the child of light, we see that indeed this verse 2 is telling us the state of an unrepentant heart. Amen?
Amen.
Verse 2 tells us the state of an unrepentant heart. There is a deep chasm. There is an emptiness which they are trying to satisfy with so many things. Isn't it? Mm-hmm. Pornography, movies, many things. Careers, money, sports. They try to fill. It's an empty waste. Empty waste. It's like an insatiable. Everything they try to accumulate to fill that empty waste is not achieving the purpose they wanted to achieve. It's like they keep accumulating wealth and things are not satisfying. Amen? An empty waste. Hungry. Hungry for the one and only who can truly satisfy the heart. Amen? The one and only who can truly solve this problem of emptiness. So there is a problem here. But you see, before we leave verse 2, indeed, when I look at this, I see really that indeed here the Lord is talking about the unrepentant heart, because as soon as I read verse 2, and darkness was upon the surface of the deep. Now you see that this was deep, deep darkness, deep to the depth of the heart. Yeah? Mm-hmm. Upon the very surface of the deep, like down there to the foundation. A huge problem. That, in verse 2, the second part, you see that only the Holy Spirit can solve this problem of the earth. Yeah? Of this unrepentant heart. That only the Holy Spirit can solve the problem of a darkened heart. But the Apostle Paul takes this verse 2, as it were, and really expounded it for us to help us understand this state of gross darkness that has consumed, arrested, captivated, captured, yeah, and consumed and overwhelmed the unrepentant heart. Yeah? Let's go to Ephesians chapter 4. So now when we go to Ephesians chapter 4, the apostle now helps us to understand this state of darkness. This state of darkness upon this very surface of the surface of the deep. What does that mean? Chapter 4. Are you there?
Mm-hmm.
We go to verse 17 to verse 20. Хорошо?
Mm-hmm. In the Lord's name, then I warn you, do not continue to live like the heathen whose thoughts are worthless and whose minds are in the dark.
And they are in the what? In the what?
In the dark.
In the dark, aha. Uh-huh.
They have no part in the life that God gives,
mm-hmm.
for they are completely ignorant and stubborn.
Mm.
They have lost all feeling of shame. They mm-hmm. give themselves over to vice and to all sorts of indecent things without restraint.
Mm-hmm.
That was not what you learned about Christ.
Mm. That is not how you learned about Christ. Now allow me to read it in the Amplified, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Because the Amplified now, because of course Amplified is it. Mm-hmm. Yes, but you begin to see the picture that the apostle points here, that how the heart is captivated, is consumed, is overwhelmed, is totally arrested by this darkness. He says, "So this I say and solemnly testify in the name of the Lord, as in His presence, that you must no longer live as the heathen, the Gentiles do." In their perverseness, in the folly, listen to this, vanity, what does the word vanity mean? Vanity means nothing. It's it's like when you say things are vain, it is vain. It's nothing. It leads to nothing.
Mm-hmm.
It says, in their perverseness, in their folly, because folly, vanity, emptiness of their souls, and the futility of their mind. So, he's saying that the perverseness of their mind is essentially talking about what Genesis is talking about there. He says, and the earth was empty waste, void. Yeah? Talking about the heart of men. That in their perverseness, in their futility, in their vanity. That means, when you hear the word futility means, they do not bring forth anything substantial. They do not bring forth fruit. Amen? So now you see that the state of an unrepentant heart is an unfruitful state. It's an unfruitful heart. Amen?
Amen.
Empty, echoing the words of Genesis. Echoing. Verse 18, it says, their moral understanding is darkened and their reasoning is beclouded. There you see the darkness then. See the darkness Genesis is talking about. It says, And the what? And darkness was upon the surface of the deep. But wait until we go deeper. It says, their reasoning is beclouded, their understanding is darkened, they are alienated, estranged, self-banished from the life of God with no share in it. And this is because of their ignorance, the want of knowledge and perception, the willful blindness, that is, the deep-seated... Wait. I didn't read it well. He said, they're alienated from the love of God. Why? Because of the ignorance, the want of knowledge, perception, and the willful blindness that is deep-seated in them. Now you hear Genesis now. It says, and darkness was upon the surface of the deep. That?
Mm-hmm.
It says, the ignorance that is deep-seated in them. Therein, in that ignorance, is the emptiness. In that ignorance, is the darkened understanding. You see the clear picture here? Deep seated in them due to their hardness of heart, to the insensitiveness of their moral nature, and in their spiritual apathy, they have become callous and past-feeling and reckless and have abandoned themselves a prey to unbridled sensuality, eager and greed. You see now, these are the things now they indulge in every form of impurity because of that emptiness. They try to take anything and everything to try and satisfy the empty heart to the insensitiveness of their moral nature. in their depraved desires. He says, they've given themselves over to what? To indulge in every form of impurity that their darkened desires may suggest and demand. Their darkened what? Their depraved desires demand a lot of things to satisfy that deep-seated emptiness in them. But it only makes things worse. Yeah? It only makes things worse. Now here, but you see, there are two things there. He says, this is not how you learn what? Christ. Amen? Now before we go to the second part, now he says, but how do you learn Christ? So you see now that there is a transformation that takes place. When he takes you from an unrepentant heart, sinful heart, to a what? A child of God. So he says, there is a problem of deep-seated darkness. But you see in the last part of verse 2 of Genesis chapter 1, now you see the Holy Spirit appearing. As if to say that the only person that can deal with this deep-seated darkness and emptiness and wastefulness is who?
The Holy Spirit.
The book of Titus chapter 3 says, can you read Titus chapter 3 verse 15? Let's see, is it 15? It says, we need a regeneration. The regeneration of the Holy Spirit. And that's what he begins to do in this. That's now, from verse 3 on 1, is, what does it say?
This chapter?
Chapter 3.
Verse?
15. What does 15 say?
All that are with me salute thee.
Are you? Okay, go up to verse 9.
Verse 9.
Okay, look for something that says the regeneration of the Holy Spirit.
But avoid the foolish questions.
Mm-hmm. Titus, eh?
Yeah.
Shall I look for it here? It is there. Titus chapter 3. You don't see it? So he says in the book of Titus chapter 3.
For we ourselves also are sometimes foolish.
Yeah, that one, he says deceiving and being deceived. He says we're being deceived and then we're deceiving others. Yes, that's also a testimony of an unrepentant heart. Yeah? But what you see in chapter 3 there, is there, verse 5, yeah? It says, but verse 4, it says, but when the kindness and the love of God our Savior appeared, yeah, he saved us, not because of righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior. Do you see?
Mm-hmm.
Verse 4, 5, and 6. Amen. Yeah. Now this is what he's speaking about in Genesis chapter 1 here. That you need the Holy Spirit to begin this work of regeneration for the earth to move, for the unrepentant heart to move from what? A state of emptiness to a state of what? Being truly satisfied. From a state of darkness to a state of light. From a state of what? Of emptiness, or of what? Of futility to fruitfulness. You need the Holy Spirit to regenerate. Amen?
Amen.
So now let's look upon this word of the Holy Spirit. It's very powerful. So now he says, so when the Holy Spirit now transforms the unrepentant, a repentant heart. So now we saw the unrepentant heart. Now when a man turns to the Lord, now, he says in 2 Corinthians 3, verse 16 and 17 and 18, he says, but when a man turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Then he says, and we beholding, as in a mirror, the glory of the Lord, are being transformed from one level of glory to another, I like to say, higher level of glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. Is that how you say it? Some translations say, and this is
even as by the Spirit of the Lord.
Some translations say, and this is done by the Holy Spirit, something like that. Amen. That means we need the Holy Spirit now to take the veil off through repentance, yeah, through faith, through believing in Christ Jesus, the one and only who can take away our sins. And then he gives us the Holy Spirit. So now he says, this work of regeneration that takes place is done by the Holy Spirit, as that we're celebrating here.
Mm-hmm.
Says the Holy Spirit, when he comes into your life, he does not leave you the same. It is impossible that the Holy Spirit that you have an encounter with the Holy Spirit, and then your life remains the same. That you have been in sexual immorality, and then you still continue in sexual immorality. Ah! Which Holy Spirit? Eh? It's like, it's not the Holy Spirit of God. He says, then God said, so now he echoes now, 2 Corinthians 4:6. He says, the God who said, let light shine out of darkness, has also shined into our heart. This is now what he was quoting. Then God said, let there be light, and there was light. Now here God is commanding light to shine into the heart that has turned unto him. Amen. The heart that received him. The heart that has confessed, that has repented from their sins. The heart, it says in Proverbs 28, verse 13, was it? Yes. It says, he that forsakes his sin shall have mercy. So now this is now the mercy now that he has poured out. And the one thing he begins to do is to command his light to shine in our hearts. To chase away the darkness from the heart. Amen. The emptiness. He says, God said, let the light shine out of the darkness. Let there be light. There was light. God saw the light was good, and then he separated the light from the darkness. And we said last time that this now, he begins, after he shines his light into your heart, he reveals your sins, and then you begin to repent. Then you begin to really see how sinful your life is. And then you begin to repent. Amen? And then you begin to receive this grace to repent. And then as he gives you the grace to repent, and then what he begins to do now is to separate you. So that if you used to go and sleep around with prostitutes, now he's separating you from prostitution. Amen? Yeah. From your sins that you used to commit. If you used to be one who has long fingers, now he's making those long fingers short. That means now, no more stealing. If you used to be the one who used to talk, you have become radio and gossiping and everything else. Now he's saying, no more gossiping. Amen?
Amen.
If you used to be the one who's hacking, whatever you're hacking, say no more hacking. Now, if you used to listen to illegal music, he said, no more illegal music. I mean, you listen illegally to music. He says, no more illegal listening to music. If you used to be one who insults, he said, no more insulting. He says, now a separation. He says, then he began to separate the light from the darkness. But you see, light and darkness never mix. You can never have light and darkness in the same heart. He says, you cannot have two gods. Either you wash, he says, what you do, you begin to do is because there's always a bias towards one. If you receive the Lord and you are really endeared to him, that means your heart has really been transformed by him, then either you worship him or you don't. I mean, you worship him. If he has truly transformed your heart, then you worship him. But if you are half-heartedness, then darkness will prevail. But he says, and then he separated the light from the darkness, and then he called the light day, and the darkness he called
night.
And then, that was not enough. He begins to separate even further, because now, first of all, he makes it very plain that this young man has repented. No question about that. So if someone says they received Jesus and they still, you are not sure. Yeah? They say they repent, and then they still continue doing the same thing. No, it's not possible. It says when he repents, and then he separated the light from the darkness. That means immediately when the people look at you, they see something has changed inside your heart. Amen? Is it true? Yeah. When you go home, they're like, what's wrong? Why are you smiling too much? Well, from one ear to another ear. From ear to ear, very big smile. If you used to be full of anger, whatever. All of a sudden, you're full of love. And they're wondering why, you know, like Paul. He says, Paul used to chase them Christians. The day, or should I say, the week he got saved, they saw something was changed. They say, isn't this the one who used to chase them, to arrest them, to put them in prison? But now look, he's preaching the same message. That means it was plain from day one or two, whatever day they saw him. Amen? There was unambiguous. It was not ambiguous. It was unambiguous. This man has been transformed, and there is no question about it. Amen? He was not saying, oh, let me just pretend as if I'm still arresting them, but I'm not really arresting because I don't want to lose my job. No. He says, he stopped all that he was doing once and for all. Separation. And then he continues the work of separation. Let water separate from the waters. Now you begin to see that now he's separating you from your old company. He says, let the water beneath be separated from the water above. He says, let the water rise. Ah, that I think that's a very powerful moment in creation. If we are given the eyes to see that, when we get to heaven, when we begin to see this day of creation, you see the water rising from the earth, or it's like this unanimous, it's as if the earth is expanding, so as it were. Yeah? Water rising and then separating from your old companionship. For he says, old, what is it? He says, bad company does what? Corrupts good manner. Now he's separating you. He's separating you. He says, there must be a distinction between your former company and your new company. Yeah? Mm-hmm. Yeah. You cannot, if you are a thief, for instance, it says even your companionship changes. You can't say, yeah, you are born again, but see, you still spend the whole day with thieves. Of course, there's a difference. I'm not saying that you get born again, you don't see those people. No, no. And when you go back there, it's to preach the gospel, not to steal with them. Yeah, now you have a new business, yeah? Not business, but a new mission.
Yeah.
It says, now a separation. And then another separation follows, which is the what? The separation of the water from the land. Now he's continuing to separate you, even in the church. Because last time we said, there are brothers who have three girlfriends, and they go to church. It says, there must be a difference between you, who is truly saved, and one who is pretending to be saved. Yeah? Isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. There must be a difference. He's saying, a difference between those that are there for show. Yeah? They are there because we do recording. They are there for show. So they wear miniskirts to show their legs off. Yeah? During worship, so that when it appears on Christian TV, they say, look, there I am. Or so that people can be attracted to watch Christian TV, whatever it is. Yeah? It says, now there must be a separation between you, who is there to worship God, and those that are there to market themselves. There are many things, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Between those that are selling the gospel and you who is truly worshiping the Lord. Yeah, because I'm saying so 1,000 seed to get a breakthrough. No. There must be a difference. And then he commands fruitfulness now. Once he separates you, then he begins to continue this work to bring forth the fruit of the Holy Spirit in your life. Because he says, let the what? The earth bring forth fruit. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah.
Mm-hmm.
With seed in it, according to their various kinds. Amen? The land produced vegetation. So I said last time that this one now speaks of the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, kindness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Amen? It says, now let it show forth. And one brother, when we're sharing on Skype, he said, it's very powerful because in Galatians 5, he said, the fruit of the Spirit. And when you come here, he's also saying, let the trees on the land that, he says, let the land produce vegetation, seed-bearing plants and trees on the land that bear fruit. He didn't say fruits. Amen? He said fruit with seed in it. Amen? So you see that now. Now, this is the fruit now. As they see that you are truly born again, now they begin to see something else exude out of your heart, out of your life. They begin to see a difference. The way you treat people is different. Amen?
Amen.
They see Christ emanating from you through the love. If you used to be full of hate, now it's just love coming out. If you used to be impatient, this tremendous patience. Others are burning out of impatience and you are just, you know, you are the one encouraging them. But come on, guys, don't worry. Whatever it is that you say, amen? There's this fruit coming out of you. This fruit, love, joy, peace, patience. You're going to a place and the Lord helps you to transform the atmosphere. Many, many, many things. That means now your life is bearing new kinds of fruit. But you see here, this is now the beginning now, another level of bearing testimony to your transformation. Now, you also hear Jesus saying, When you read this, you also hear Jesus saying, do thorn bushes bring forth apples? What word do you use? Or oranges, whatever. Or grapes? He says, no. And do grape trees, grapevines bring forth thistles? He says, it's impossible. That means when the Holy Spirit begins to do such a work in you of transformation, then you begin to bring forth that fruit now that John says, that is what? Fitting for repentance. The fruit worthy of repentance. The fruit that testified to the repentance in your heart. Amen? That fruit. And then after that, you hear him say, day four, he says, and then let what? Light. Now he's talking about light shining, isn't it? He says, and separate the light from the darkness. Now he's talking about the light to govern the day and the light to govern the night. And this is now talking about, you also hear Jesus in Matthew chapter 5. Read Matthew chapter 5 now. This is where Matthew chapter 5 is. This is now Matthew chapter 5 now.
16. Make your light so shine.
Start from the bush. Do men light a lamp and put it under a bushel? Yes.
Verse 14.
You are a city, you are light, you are the light
we
of the world.
We are the light of the world.
Uh-huh.
A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid.
Uh-huh.
Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel,
but
on a candlestick,
and
it giveth light
to
all that are in
the house. Amen.
16. Let your light so shine before men,
amen,
that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven.
Yes. And glorify your Father which is in heaven. Now he's saying, now when you begin to bring forth this fruit, now here now you are beginning to shine. So see, now this fruit now, this is now your light shining. Now you are becoming a testimony to the sins of the world. Now you are rebuking the sins of the world. Says now you are expelling the darkness around you. Now your life is shining. Because you cannot be transformed by the Holy Spirit and you are still in sexual sin and then expect light to shine.
Impossible.
Ain't no light shining. Amen. Sexual immorality is darkness, it's not light. You see? So someone says they are born again, but they are still sinning. Now how are they going to testify Christ with stealing cars? While they are stealing cars or stealing money from the office. That's not shining the light. If you are insulting on TV and you say you are born again, you are not shining the light. Amen?
Amen.
But if you are going forth with the fruit of the Holy Spirit, then that's shining the light. You are loving. You are going out in love. You are going out in patience. You are not the one who is breaking out in anger. Breaking out in anger is not shining the light. But walking in patience, that's shining the light. Goodness. When you are walking in goodness, that's shining the light, isn't it? Says now you are exposed. Now you have been. It's as if the Lord is saying you are sitting on the hill. It's a sin. Now He has brought you to a place of accountability. Now He has brought you to a place where you cannot escape. Now He's saying that light must shine because the light has to shine in the darkness. The people that are in the darkness must see the light. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah, because He says. In the land of Zebulun, the land of Naphtali, Galilee of the Gentiles, I think that's what he said. He says, a people that sat in deep darkness have seen a great light. Amen?
Amen.
Your light like that of Christ must shine to those that are in the darkness. That is the hope of this world. Amen?
Amen.
He says, and then after he commands the light to shine, he says, now your light is shining in this darkness, because we know that we are living in a very dark world. It says, now as we begin to walk in the fruit of the Holy Spirit, now our light is shining. And the world around us is seeing who? The work of Christ in us. Amen?
Amen.
Then after that, on the fifth day, he commands the animals to be created. No, he creates the animals. Amen?
Amen?
Now when he creates the animals, now this is another level of bearing fruit. He says, well, the fruit of the Holy Spirit in you shines the light. But now there's another fruitfulness. This fruitfulness, he says, now he's talking about animals. He's talking about animals that must also produce after their kind. Now here he's talking about evangelism. He's talking about shining the light of Christ. Now he's talking about evangelizing Jesus to make disciples. Go to Matthew chapter 28. Now we hear Matthew 28 verse 18 and 19. Amen. Matthew 28:18-19. What does it say there?
And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying,
yes,
all power is given unto me,
yes,
in heaven and in earth.
Amen.
Go ye therefore,
uh-huh,
and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father,
yes,
and of the Son,
yes,
and of the Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah. That's all? Verse 20?
Teaching them to observe all things
that I have commanded,
whatsoever I have commanded you.
Mm-hmm.
And lo, I am with you always.
Hallelujah.
Even unto the end of the world.
Amen.
Amen.
And go and make disciples of all the nations.
Amen.
This creating of the animals speaks of, because you see that it is the animals that entered into the ark. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
That is the picture of the church entering into heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Evangelism. Hallelujah.
Mm-hmm.
Then after that, then what happened? Then the sixth day. Then he says, let us create
man
in our own image, after our own likeness. And let them what? Let them rule over
birds of the
air. Over the birds of the air. Over the livestock.
The fowl of the air.
Over the fowl of the air, yes. Over the wild animals.
Over all the
fish. All the creatures that move along the ground. Now you see here now, you say, now when he has taken you through all these transformative processes, now you hear him say, now he has brought you to a place where you are moving and walking in authority.
Mm-hmm.
But listen, he says this, let us make man in our own image. Ha. He's saying, to as many as received him, to them he gave the power. He says, when you are walking in this way, now, shining the light, bearing fruit, disciple making, walking like Jesus. He's saying, now, you are being now a true image bearer of Christ. Now you are bearing the image of Christ in this world that so desperately needs him. Now you're being, now you're here. You're here now, Apostle Paul said, you are ambassadors of Christ. Since you are the ministers of reconciliation. Since you are the ambassadors of Christ, preaching this gospel of reconciliation. Now you are the image bearers. He's saying, now you are the body of Christ. Of course, he makes you the body of Christ when he transforms you to make your church. Now he's just showing you these things that take place. He says, now, when you are walking in this way, you are bearing the image of Christ. We know that man was created in the image of Christ. Romans 3:23 says, but for all have sinned, fallen short of the glory of Christ. That image is restored in us when we receive Christ Jesus. And when we walk in this way, now we begin to truly bear the image of Christ. You cannot bear the image of Christ when you are just not bearing fruit. When you are not, because it says in John 15 talks about much about bearing fruit. But you see, when you also hear about bearing fruit, you hear him saying, any fruit, any tree, any branch. He says, I am the vine. John 15.
Yes.
I am the vine and you are the branches. He says, any branch that does not bring fruit shall be what?
Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he taketh away.
Shall be cut out. And what? And thrown into the fire.
Uh-huh.
See? The warning against fruitlessness. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
It is a command. It says we have to walk in this way. Because when we walk in this way, then we are being the true image bearers. Bearing fruit. Shining the light. You see, another level of shining the light. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
Male and female, he created them. Now, I love this one. This one I didn't mention last time. But you see, he created what? Eve afterwards. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
He created Eve. When he created Eve, he said, it is not good that a man be alone. What will he do?
Therefore,
I will create him. No, yes, because before that, he showed him all the animals.
Mm-hmm.
The donkeys and the chickens, and he said, these ones, they are not for you. Mm-hmm. There is no help meat for you.
Mm-hmm.
Everything else.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, it is not good that you be alone.
Mm-hmm.
I will create what? I will make a help meat for him.
Mm-hmm.
Help meat. He creates Eve. When he creates Eve, I cannot help but think of the bride of Christ. Amen? Because when you go to Ephesians chapter 5, you find the apostle saying, he says, for this reason, man shall leave his father and mother, shall be united to his wife. And then he says, but I'm speaking about Christ and the church. He says, this is a great mystery. Oh, are you there?
Yes.
Read it. Says, are you getting it? Am I confused?
For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother,
yes,
shall be joined unto his wife.
Yes.
And they shall be one flesh.
Become one flesh.
This is a great mystery.
This is a great mystery.
But I speak concerning Christ and the church.
I'm speaking about Christ and the church. Meaning now, this man learned so much from Genesis. Meaning, when you look at Adam and Eve, he's speaking about the Christ and the church. Amen? And even marriage itself is speaking about Christ and the church. And that's where now you hear Revelation 19, he says, and they shouted a great sound, a sound like a voice of multitude, voice of many multitudes, something like that. He says, shouting, hallelujah, for the Lord our God Almighty reigns. Now, he says, let us shout and give him glory, for the day of the Lamb of God has arrived, or for the day of the wedding lamp, yes, has arrived, and the bride has made herself ready. She was given to be clothed in fine linen, bright and clean. The fine linen stands for the righteousness of the saints. Now you see here, Eve is speaking of the message that Eve contains is the message of the bride of Christ. Amen? It's the message of the bride of Christ. He's saying, I'm speaking about Christ and the church here. So now when he gets to the end of the creation, he's saying now, after he has created this, after he has transformed you and made you a true image bearer of Christ and walking in the authority of the power of the Holy Spirit, for as many as believed him, to them he gave
power.
Now he says, now walking in this power and bearing the image of Christ, he's saying, now you have now been made, he says, you have now become. He's now speaking of the church. He said, now you have become now the church that is the bride of Christ. Amen? Now he's speaking.